This presentation is on the topic of nanoparticles for drug delivery. Let's start with a definition of what is a nanoparticle. And in general, when we talk about nanoparticles, we're talking about particles that on the size scale, the diameter is less than 100 nanometers, or really around 100 nanometers. That's how it's defined, at least in the ISO and in the ASTM standards. I give you the references for here. But this becomes a bit more confused when the European Union came out with their definition of nanoparticles. They say that 50% of the number distribution should be between 1 and 100 nanometers. And that really kind of muddies the water. The rest of the world just kind of says around 100 nanometers. The reason the EU actually came up with a more complicated definition is really about nano safety concerns, and they came up with a risk assessment flowchart, which you see here, in different categories of particles. And they're saying there should be some kind of risk assessment when down into this category 3. But this really isn't specifically to pharmaceutical products. This is for more commercial products, products that consumers might be in contact with. So usually we're talking about under 100 nanometers, but that definition gets stretched occasionally. And when I was doing the research for this particular presentation, I actually looked up and found this one definition. And if we talk about nanoparticles for drug delivery to the brain, someone decided we can stretch that up to a micron. I don't really call that a nanoparticle, but I'm just showing this because other people stretch this definition, and if something's at 110 nanometers, sure, we can still call that a nanoparticle. Is a 1 micron particle a nanoparticle? Not in my book, but it depends on how people are using the definitions. And it's all, not only a question of application and definition, but also agenda. I think there's a lot of university research in the field of nanoparticles. In the world, nanoparticles helps win grants. And I think that, as much as anything else, has helped spread this definition of what a nanoparticle is. But most of the data you will see in the talk today will be particles down here on the 100 nanometer size scale. And if we're going to measure particles down on the scale of 100 nanometers, the most common technique is dynamic light scattering. Dynamic light scattering works by using light scattering to pick up on the signature from Brownian motion. So here we see this particle, the yellow particle. It is a particle in a suspension of water. So these are actually the water molecules moving, and the water molecules bang against the particle, and it creates this random thermal motion. With dynamic light scattering, we have a light source. The sample just sits in a cuvette. We have a detector. And what we do is we look at this light scattering due to the Brownian motion of the particle. This light scattering creates a function, which is a correlation function. From the correlation function, we actually dig out this D is not diameter, but the translational diffusion coefficient. And then from the diffusion coefficient, we use the Stokes-Einstein equation to calculate our radius. Most of the data you're going to see today is actually going to be DLS data. And even if I don't mention it, I wouldn't show any data in one of my talks unless all of it comes from one of our instruments, and the instrument we use for dynamic light scattering is a Nikon. There are many reasons why working at the smaller scale down at 100 nanometers is very beneficial in the world of pharmaceutics. One of them is because there's a real barrier to getting some drugs to market, which has to do with water solubility. And water solubility, you can look at this in terms of the dissolution rate. The equation we use to describe dissolution rate in the pharmaceutical industry is the Noyes-Whitney equation. We're talking about this dC dt. This is the dissolution rate, the change of concentration as a function of time. And the factors involved are, this again isn't diameter, this is diffusion coefficient, the area of the particle. So the size is in here, and then also down here as we talk about h, the size of the particle kind of is involved here. This is the diffusional distance. So we look at the change of the concentration near the surface of the particle in the bulk. And as we change the size, we also change h. So there's actually two factors where particle size changes the dissolution rate. Now if we take a 100 micron crystal, and if we were to say mill that down to 10 microns, we have an increase in the surface area of a factor of 10. But if we have some way to get it down to the scale of 100 nanometers, then we increase it 1,000-fold. So a 1,000-fold increase in the area exposed by a decrease in the size actually has a great impact on the dissolution rate. And this makes it much easier for the drug to be water soluble, which makes it easier to administer to the patient. Now, nanocrystals themselves are a pure drug. They usually need to be stabilized somehow. And we also have to think about the method of delivery. So some of what we'll talk about today is the nanoparticles as the nanocrystal, and sometimes it'll be just using nanoparticles as the delivery method, using it for drug delivery. This is some data I found, and I always give, if this isn't my research, I always give the references at the bottom here. And this is a lipid-based liquid crystalline nanoparticle, and there was an issue of this poor solubility, which makes it difficult to administer to the patient. So this is research creating these lipid-based liquid crystalline nanoparticles, where there's an SEM here showing you the crystalline nature of these particles. Now, here's an SEM looking at the particles, and you can use SEM to get a feel for the particle size. And as I look at this photomicrograph, I see these smaller particles, and then I see these larger ones. So actually, there's some small and some large particles. Now, if you measure this sample using a dynamic light scattering system, if you just look at a Gaussian distribution where we make it fit to a normalized distribution, you'd say it's a single population. But one of the real benefits of the NICOMP DLS system is the NICOMP algorithm, using a non-negative least squares approach, actually is the highest resolution DLS system and is able to dig out this bimodal distribution, which you can see with your eyes. But when you use DLS, you can actually see as you do the measurement, it's actually flagged right on the screen, which is saying, wait a second, we have a large chi-square. You should switch over to the NICOMP algorithm. And then we see this bimodal, which better describes the size distribution of these particles. That is one of the kind of claims of fame of the NICOMP system, is this algorithm. If you look at taking two polystyrene latex standards that are 100 and 170 nanometers, if you use a Gaussian distribution, you just create a smoothed curve between the two. But using this NICOMP distribution, we can actually split these two peaks. And we believe we have the most sensitive algorithm for being able to split these peaks that are fairly close to each other. Here, we see the NICOMP algorithm splitting peaks for PSLs that are 100 and 170, and here 150 and 200 nanometers into their individual peaks. So that is part of why the NICOMP system is so popular, because it really has this ability to be able to tell you this is a system that is bimodal or trimodal and can give you the real picture of what's going on with the particle size distribution. So let's talk about some of the nanoparticle drugs commonly on the market. There's something like 43 drugs that are currently on the market where we could say a nanoparticle is part of either the drug or the delivery route. Of these, you know, a lot of them were probably approved, 15 of them I think were approved before the year 2000, and in recent years it actually hasn't been a big uptake in terms of the speed of drugs being approved. So actually I think there's still a lot of room for growth, because there's a lot of things that still haven't made it onto the market. And as we look at some of the nanoparticle drugs in trial, and these happen to be pegylated, and I'll talk later on, you can actually coat nanoparticles with polyethylene glycol. And this actually helps, it stabilizes it, but also helps keep it in the system. It's so by hiding it from the macrophages, we can actually keep it in the patient for longer, recirculates longer, and can keep hammering on the tumors, for instance, if we're using it for an anti-cancer drug. So these are just some of the pegylated polymeric nanoparticles currently in clinical trials. And I'm just going to point out this one, BIND-014, which is actually docetaxel, which is inside something called an acurin, which we'll discuss later, is one where I have some additional information on. So the actual drug in here is Taxotere. And this is looking at the pharmacokinetic data for if you were to administer this drug to a patient, just the drug itself, this is at the same dose, 30 milligrams. And this is looking at the concentration in plasma as a function of time. And if you look at the drug itself, it drops off to zero very quickly if it's just the drug itself. But when we encapsulate it inside a polyethylene glycol nanoparticle, and you look at the concentration as a function of time, here you see a great extension of the time there's a useful concentration in the blood. It's something like a 250-fold increase. As you look at the area under the curve, that is the AUC in the third panel of this table. And what you see is an AUC of 512 versus 127,000. So about a 250-fold increase by taking the drug and then using a different drug delivery route using a nanoparticle for drug delivery. So this is the promise of using nanoparticles for drug delivery, often taking existing drugs, but finding a better way to deliver to the patient to improve the drug delivery profile. And in this case, it kind of just turns into a controlled release approach, keeps the drug in the patient for longer. It also helps in other ways, such as toxicity and some other ways as well. Probably the grandfather drug that's a nanoparticle that has been formulated and has been in use for many years is doxorubicin, which is Doxil, pegylated form of doxorubicin. So that's the drug, and in this case, it's actually wrapped up inside a liposome. So a liposome is a lipid bilayer, and we can take a water-soluble drug and hide it in the hydrophilic core. But then by using this approach, we can actually be able to get it to be stable in a water dispersion. And we can also do some work on the surface. Some of the drug particles we'll see today have surface modification to help target it. And there's various antigens, ligands we could add to the surface so that this will go out and seek things like tumors and try to selectively adhere onto the surface of tumors. So a lot of these drugs are actually for anti-cancer drugs, and this is one of the drugs that's been on the market for quite a while. This is an article I found of doxorubicin nanoparticles. So this is a polymer lipid hybrid nanoparticle. And the people here said, well, we need to know what the particle size is. And here is the SCM photograph, and here is a result from the NICOMP DLS system. And again, as I look here, I see these smaller particles, and then I see the larger ones. And the bimodal is split here again using the NICOMP DLS system. So a much more realistic representation of the particle size distribution by using the NICOMP to perform the particle size. And actually, if I had my hands on this NICOMP, I could go in and tweak the NICOMP algorithm and get a much finer resolution of the two peaks. So again, just showing off the ability of using the NICOMP for high resolution dynamic light scattering particle size analysis. The NICOMP can also be used to measure the zeta potential. The zeta potential is the charge on the surface of the particles. If we want to make stable particles, then we usually want to add charge to the surface, because if there's a charge on the surface, then the particles are less likely to aggregate. This is data from the Journal of Controlled Release. This is a nanoparticle with a lipid coating for delivery of siRNA. This is a process to create these, and then what we're going to do is to formulate them in liposomes. And this is a picture of the drug formulated inside this liposome. And in this case, they looked at particle size and the zeta potential, and looked at the ratio of the concentration of the lipid to the siRNA of the actual drug. And as we look here, if you look to particle size on the left, that is the square data, and then to the right, the zeta potential, you see as we change this molar ratio, we actually see the zeta potential go from negative up to positive. And it doesn't matter if the charge is negative or positive in terms of the stability, it's just the magnitude of the charge. So this area would be stable and this area would be stable. But when the ratio reaches this level, and we see that the zeta potential is essentially zero, look at what happens to the particle size. As soon as you reach zero zeta potential, we have probably aggregation and a very large increase in the size of the nanoparticles, to where this probably wouldn't be as effective. It's a very good idea when doing this work on nanoparticles to keep track of both the particle size and also the zeta potential. And the NICOMP DLS system is an excellent tool for doing both of those measurements. I had recently put out a technical note showing off the low-level concentration abilities of the NICOMP. So what I was taking was lysozyme, which is a protein with a known size near 3.5 nanometers. And I mixed it up at 10 milligrams per ml, and then I diluted it to 1 mg per ml and down to 0.1 mg per ml. And this showed how we get the same size, a little broadening, but the ability to measure at very low concentrations, this very small protein, which is a very weak scatterer. This is just the repeats of those measurements. By the way, when I'm doing the most difficult work, I'm actually using this cell here where I take the sample and I put it in a refractive index matching cell. And I should probably put the reference here to a technical note we have on sample preparation for DLS, which gives the details of how it's possible to get this excellent data generated at very low concentrations. I'm mentioning this because as I researched for today's talk, I ran into this paper where people are talking about polyolin bioconjugates. So there's a drug and you bioconjugate with a polymer. And it's folated and non-folated. So the drug, again, was this doxorubicin, which we've mentioned, and also doxorubicin with folic acid. What I show here, and this is data from this customer, published in the European Journal of Pharmaceutical Sciences. A and B is for the polymer with PEG and cysteamine. And you see data at 0.2 mg per mil and at 5 in the same data. So I thought this was interesting, both the data itself and the fact that they were able to create excellent data down here at 0.2 mg per mil, showing off the ability of the NICOMP to work at very low concentrations. Then C and D here, this is the conjugate of the polyolin polymer, doxorubicin. And down here we have also data for a more complex system, but you can see excellent data down here at very low concentrations and the ability to detect these bimodal distributions. So I thought this was actually excellent NICOMP data being used by our customers in creating this kind of complicated bioengineered particle. A lot of people use a NICOMP for measuring liposomes. And in this case, this paper was published talking about liposome processing. This was an article, Enhanced Oral Bioavailability, a Cyclosporin A by Liposomes Containing a Biosalt. And what they're looking at is the change in the size and also the polydispersity. Polydispersity is how we express the width of the distribution using dynamic light scattering. And this is showing results before and after we process the liposome through a homogenizer. And what we see is the result before the homogenizer step, up near a micron, which is closer to the upper limit of DLS. But then as it was processed through this homogenizer, we see this large decrease down to the scale where it's about 80 nanometers. This is looking at, can we reduce the particle size down to the nanometer scale near 100 nanometers? So in this case, it was processed through a homogenizer. And they found that at 100 bar, it worked very well. But then if they increase the homogenizer pressure to 200 bars, then there was some disruption of the liposomes, and the data was not as attractive. So in this case, this is using the lab instrument to understand the proper processing conditions for creating these liposomes. These measurements are mostly made in the lab, but can also now be made in process, and I'm going to show you some in-process data now. So we talked about BIND 14. The BIND 14 is one of the Acurin technology particles being created by BIND, where the drug is inside a polymer latex. It's usually a pegylated surface. And then they can also do targeting ligands on the surface to try to promote selective adhesion, for instance, to tumor sites. The particle size is critical here. And in creating this, there actually is a step where there's a high-pressure homogenizer. So in one of the steps for creating these polymeric nanoparticles, there is a step where there is a homogenizer. And downstream of the homogenizer, what we're doing is we're taking the sample, putting it through the fluidics, and up here what you see is we take the sample comes in here, we have a dilution stream. It's actually not pure water, it's a little more complicated in this case. And what we do is then take the diluted sample up into the cell where we take the measurement, do the measurement, clean up, and move on to the next sample. The diluent source here is actually pressurized to come into the fluidics, and this way we can actually can perform DLS systems in process. Here is a picture of this instrument in the customer's processing plant. So the fluidics is up here. This is where the sensor is, and we're keeping the diluent down here pressurized so we can pump in pressurized diluent to perform the dilution of the measurement. This is downstream of homogenizer, and what this customer wanted to do was understand what are the optimum conditions for creating the desired particle size. The plot here you see is particle size versus homogenizer pressure. The particle size is these blue diamonds, and what you see is as we increase the pressure on the right y-axis in this red graph line, as we increase the pressure, we reduce the particle size. By creating a series of trials, the customer was able to understand this response, as you see plotted here, of size versus homogenizer pressure, that effectively every time you reduce the homogenizer pressure by 1,000 psi, you'll get a change of 9 nanometers. This relationship between homogenizer pressure and particle size was understood, And then we could start using the instrument for process control. So here we see particle size again on the left, homogenizer pressure on the right. And at the beginning of the process, what we see is here at 93 nanometers, this is a bit smaller than the size desired. The desired particle size was right at 100 nanometers. Then by reducing the homogenizer pressure, we actually could get the particles right up into this desired size range. Once the conditions are completely optimized, then we can actually use the system. This is just showing particle size versus sample number taken. Then we can actually control the particle size very tightly over the course of the entire batch. Now, these are very high value batches, and by using this online size measurement, it actually is possible to make sure that 100% of the batch is within control. And that's something you really can't do by taking the sample and running it to lab and getting the sample back to the process environment. This is showing how we can use the online DLS data for continuous process control of this homogenizer operation and can successfully keep all the particles within the desired specification range. That's the data I wanted to share with you today. Nanoparticles for drug delivery is rapidly advancing both in terms of R&D and implementation. I've shown you quite a few drugs in the nano size scale that are already on the market, even more currently in clinical trial. When creating these drugs and in the processing, the particle size is a key issue. And how are we going to do this measurements? Well, if we're working down in the scale near 100 nanometers, dynamic light scattering is the favored technique. And the Nicomp DLS gives you the highest resolution results, which is why it's very popular for use both in the laboratory. And now that we have also proven we can do this in line with our dilution fluidics, it's being popular both in the lab and online. Unfortunately, what I couldn't show today is what if there are a few oversized particles in the batch? How are you going to detect those? Because your DLS isn't going to detect particles up at over 1 or 10 microns or so. The other technique, which is available through PSS, is the AccuSizer, which is a single particle optical sizing system where we count and size particles one at a time. And it's the most sensitive technique for catching a few oversized particles. No one has published using this, although I can tell you people do use the instrument for that, probably because most people don't publish this is the unwanted data. But if you do have concern for a few large particles, then the PSS AccuSizer is a technique we'd recommend for that. And if you'd like more information on using the AccuSizer for oversized particles, please visit our website at pssnicomp.com.